an LPI virtual seminar this week. Our guest this week is Ava Scheller, who's going to be giving us a talk about the fate of Martian water. Really exciting results that we've seen from that. And so we're really excited to see to have your talk. Ava is a PhD candidate at Caltech and got her BS at the University of Copenhagen in Geosciences. With that, let's go ahead and take it away, Ava. Glad to have you.
Thanks so much, Sean. Thank you everyone for coming to this talk. So as Sean said, I'm a PhD candidate at Caltech right now, and I work on a lot of different topics, mostly pertaining to ancient climate on Mars and also on Earth. I do a combination of remote sensing and work with the Perseverance rover, as well as working on stable isotopes and clumped isotopes in the lab. Today the talk is going to be on the topic of the fate of water on Mars and how we can trace water rock interactions through modeling satellites and rovers and the integrations of these different data sets. So I was invited to talk about this recent study that was published in the beginning of April. And so this is a paper in Science. And so if you have some time, check it out and feel free to email me any questions or ask any questions today if you're interested in the study and its findings. A lot of this work is also from my co-authors that you see listed here. So of course, a big thanks to all of them. So I want to start by taking a step back and talking a little bit about NASA's obsession, or maybe our obsession, with water on Mars. And no matter if you study Mars or you don't, you have probably seen headlines like these coming out of a lot of different sort of NASA news articles and that kind of thing, that sort of seems like we keep wanting to rediscover water on Mars. And so the question is, why do we keep having all these new studies on water on Mars? What kinds of water was there, and what time this water was there? And it really all comes back to habitability, which defined is the ability of an environment to support the activity of at least one known organism. We often think about habitability as the Venn diagram of a lot of different components that are listed here. But liquid water in particular is important because it encompasses two parts of this Venn diagram, which is that it provides a solvent and it also provides evidence of appropriate physical chemical conditions for sustaining life, at least as we know it from Earth. And the reason that we keep wanting to characterize the nature of this water through geological time is because we want to understand specifically what we call continuous planetary habitability, which is the capacity of a planetary body to sustain habitable conditions over geological timescales. And that's because you can think of habitability as sort of a instantaneous moment or very short-lived episode, but a lot of the times when we think about life to arise or to evolve, we need geological timescales. At least for life as we know it on Earth. So let's take a step back and talk about how we actually know that there's water on Mars. So we have for decades or even half a century analyzed geomorphological features of the Martian surface that are indicative of a lot of water in Mars's past. So you may have seen these Viking photos of channel systems that represent ancient river systems at the time of formation. Later on, we got more high resolution satellite imagery, like this image here, showing these channels in more detail, or even features like that has been attributed to be a delta within a lake system where the Perseverance rover has just landed. And then we even have interpretation of possible shoreline features for this northern half of the Martian globe. So previous studies had actually tried to put a volume range of how much water was necessary to make these geological structures. So I have, here's sort of a summary of a lot of these different studies that are calculated based on either these potential shoreline features or fluvial channel fan features. There are other studies out there as well, but in general, their calculations fall within this range of 100 to 1,000 meters GL. GL stands for global equivalent layer, and it really just means if you covered the whole surface of Mars with a 1 meter thick layer of water, that would be 1 meter GL of water. And I'm going to be using this unit throughout the talk because it's just a bit easier than talking about cubic meters of water and that kind of thing. So in general, we have some calculations based on these geological structures that show that ancient Mars did have a pretty significant volume of water to form all of these different geomorphological features. So we can actually also measure this from a different perspective. We can actually measure the concentration of water in the Martian crust. And a lot of studies and missions have focused on doing that. There's actually so many studies that I can't go through all of them today, but I'm going to hit some of the key findings that have led to my work here. And so one of the big findings is that with infrared spectroscopy data from, for example, the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, which is a satellite that circles around Mars coming out of a NASA mission. This infrared spectroscopy instrument has found that there's a lot of water-bearing minerals in the ancient crust on Mars. So these water-bearing minerals are represented by all of these different dots in this plot. You'll see that most of them are phyllosilicates, which are represented by these blue dots. And the majority of these phyllosilicates are actually clay minerals, specifically iron magnesium clay minerals. And so clay, but also other types of water-bearing minerals, so like serpentines, chlorides, hydrated sulfate, silicas, or maybe even hydrated carbonates, are all water-bearing minerals that we have found to have formed on the Martian surface, among others. Another striking finding is that we can observe that most of these water-bearing minerals occur in the really ancient crust on Mars. So we divide the geological history of Mars into three periods based on crater chronology, very similar to what we've done on the Moon. The most ancient period is called Dinuwankian, which spans from 4 to about 3.7 billion years ago. Because these periods are based on crater chronology, there's of course some uncertainty towards the absolute age of these periods, but this is the most ancient period. The middle period is called the Hesperian, and then the youngest period representing about the past 3 billion years is called the Amazonian. And so if you transform all of these hydrated minerals into all these yellow dots, you'll see that they co-occur mostly with these green and orange areas that represent the ancient Martian and Hesperian crust from 4 to 3 billion years ago. Now we can also measure the actual concentration of water. So this is a different infrared spectroscopic data set coming off of the Mars Express Orbiter, which is sort of the ESA counterpart to the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter. And for this purpose, we will just ignore the polar regions because that's where we have a lot of ice also controlling water concentrations. But if we focus mostly on this ancient crust part here in the mid latitudes, the water content of the crust ranges from being 2.5 to 6 weight percent of water. So there's actually quite a lot of water that we can determine from orbital spectroscopy. So then the question is, have we actually ground truthed this? Can we actually, you know, one thing is observing this from orbit, but can we go to the surface and measure similar concentrations of water? And the answer to that question is we have actually done that with the Curiosity rover. So the Curiosity rover contained an instrument called Sample Analysis at Mars, or SAM. And the way that this instrument works is that you actually drill a hole. So these drill holes here are actual drill holes on Mars. And then you extract that material, pass it into an oven that's going to heat the material and release the gas. And then you measure how much water is in that gas using a mass spectrometer. And so here are the results from a range of different samples. All these acronyms here, these are just acronyms for the sample names that have been taken with the Curiosity rover. And you can see that SAM has measured that there's about 1 to 38% of water within these different Martian surface samples. And we've actually also measured with our mineralogical instruments what kinds of mineralogy is containing this water. And again, we're seeing a lot of this water is contained within these iron, magnesium clays and other water-bearing minerals. Furthermore, we have actually an example of brecciated ancient Martian crust represented in the meteorite that we know as Black Beauty. It is the only meteorite that represents crust from this ancient period. And very similar to the experience performed with the Curiosity rover, we have measured that there's about 0.5% of water within this meteorite, locked within also water-bearing minerals in this case. So if you integrate all these different data sets, we see that there is a water concentration range of about 0.5% to 6% of water in this really ancient crust, as measured at many different scales of measurements from the lab to orbit. So now we know sort of roughly the concentration of water in the crust. We also want to understand the vertical structure of this hydrated crust. So how deep is this hydrated crust occurring? That's kind of a hard thing to do. We don't necessarily have instruments that are designed to do that kind of analysis yet, but we do fortuitously have excavated pieces of specifically the Noachian crust. Because we're looking at such an old time period, we actually have so many huge impacts that have excavated very deep into the crust. We also have extremely deep canyon systems. So when I say deep canyon systems, they're actually about 10 kilometers deep, which is kind of exotic, at least for Earth conditions. But if you look, for example, in these impact craters, what's important to note when you're looking at an impact crater that's really large compared to a small impact crater, which is basically just like a bowl shape, is that you start uplifting material in the middle of the impact crater. So that's, in complex craters, is what we call the central uplift, which is shown in this diagram here. And that material is actually going to represent the deepest material excavated within the crater. So there are studies like this study from Sullivan and Millikan 2015 that measure specifically the water-bearing crust within the central uplift to see how deep this water-bearing material actually occurs in the crust. And in this case, they see that these iron magnesium smectites, or these iron magnesium clays, and another water-bearing mineral called chlorite actually occurs down to 7 kilometers depth. So in general, these hydrated minerals, or this hydrated crust, occurs really deep within the Noachian crust, down to 5 to 10 kilometers of what at least we have excavated so far. So now you have a concentration of water in the crust, you have, you know, a area that you can calculate, and you also have a approximate vertical depth of how deep this water-bearing material actually occurs in the crust. And so you can actually calculate the volume of water that is within this Noachian crust. And so if you use this range of different measurements that we have, you arrive at about 100 to 900 meters GL of water in the Noachian crust. The Hesperian crust is a bit less well constrained because we have less vertical excavation of it. But in general, we observe that there is less water-bearing material within the Hesperian crust, but it might range to be about Noachian values, orders of magnitude lower. And there's just a bit of uncertainty that we haven't quite figured out yet. Then we can go and ask, how much water is present on Mars today? And today we see that most of the water is present within the poles or in mid-latitude ice deposits. Of course, there's some amount of water in the atmosphere as well, but it's pretty small compared to the ice. We can actually measure how much water is in these ice deposits, and it amounts to about 20 to 40 meters GL. And this is primarily based on radar data, where we can actually resolve water-bearing layers within, for example, the South Pole, like in this this vertical section with the Mars's radar data of the South Pole. So let's summarize all these different data sets and findings that I've just summarized. So on early Mars, we see that there's about 100 to 1,000 meters GL of water. In general, there must have been much more liquid surface water than we see today. This is based both on these geomorphological observations, but also the actual observations of water-bearing minerals in the crust that have formed through interaction with this liquid water and the rocks in the crust. And then today we see that the water is about 20 to 40 meters GL. And so we know that the water levels have decreased, but we don't necessarily know why they decreased or how they decreased. So you'll see I have these stippled lines just representing that we don't really know which pathway the water took to reach the present day levels. So that's going to lead to the thesis question of this particular study, which is, okay, so we know that water levels decrease. So where did it go? What happened to it? There are other studies that have studied this. We aren't the first ones, but most of these studies suggested that the water was lost due to atmospheric escape. There's a very good reason for why we actually think atmospheric escape should have a huge role to play in the loss of water on Mars, and that's because atmospheric escape leaves a very specific hydrogen isotopic signal in the Martian atmosphere. And that's simply because lighter atoms are more likely to escape than heavier atoms. So in this doodle I have here, you can see that the heavier deuterium atom is being left over in the atmosphere while all the lighter hydrogen is just going into space and disappearing. And so because of that, we expect there to be an increase in the deuterium to hydrogen isotopic ratios, or what I'm going to call D to H. And that's going to occur because of this atmospheric escape. So we have actually measured these hydrogen isotopic ratios within a lot of different materials for this exact reason. For the ancient atmospheric reservoir, we have measured D to H in, for example, the ELH 8401 meteorite, which is really old, and also the ancient materials in Gale Crater that we've measured with this SAM instrument on the Curiosity rover. And so these ancient atmospheric compositions range from about 2 to 4 times SMO. You'll see that for the SAM rocks, there's actually a dashed line here representing some of the current measurements that are still unpublished, but you can actually see that there's a lot of data there that could actually help us constrain this ancient hydrogen isotopic composition a bit better for Mars. For the present day atmosphere, we also have a lot of measurements, both with this SAM instrument that has directly measured the atmosphere, or through telescopic observations of the atmosphere and also younger meteorites as well. And you'll see the ranges of all these data here range from about 5 to a maximum of 10 times SMO. So there's some ranges to the isotopic compositions for the present day and for the ancient Mars, but in general, the D2H values have actually increased over time. So that's compatible with what we're thinking atmospheric escape, what kind of signal that should create. And that's what led us to think that atmospheric escape should have a pretty large role to play. So there are some issues that come up when we think about atmospheric escape as the sole reason for Mars losing its water. The first one is that we can actually measure how much hydrogen is getting lost at the exobase today on Mars. We have measurements of this from the MAVEN and the Mars Express orbiters. And the hydrogen escape rates, if you integrated them over geological time, would actually amount to 2 meters GL of water. So compared to the 100 to 1,000 meters GL of water, that's a pretty small amount of water. If in some time periods, we have a bit higher of a hydrogen escape rate, and in even integrating that really extreme hydrogen escape rate would only amount to 20 meters GL of water. So to put it further into context, you would actually need a hydrogen escape rate that is up here in this red bar that I put to account for the loss of 100 to 1,000 meters GL of water. We can also look at what past studies have calculated how much water could have been lost through atmospheric escape only. And you'll see that these results range from 10 to a maximum of 200 meters shield of water. While this estimate appears a bit better compared to what we expect, these are kind of in the lower end of this 100 to 1,000 meter GL expectation from the geological data. And then you'll also see that most of these estimates aren't compatible with the modern hydrogen escape rate, like we talked about in the previous slide. So let's take a look at how these models work. In this sort of classic model, what you'll have to do is you have to approximate the atmosphere, liquid, water, and ice that are in isotopic exchange and reach like an isotopic equilibrium. You have to approximate that as a single reservoir that we call the exchangeable reservoir. And this exchangeable reservoir has a single loss, which is the loss of water to space. Then we have a development in this model in which we also have an input of water from volcanic gassing, because there's actually a lot of water that the gases with volcanic processes. So we kind of ask, what else could be going on? And so this is my doodle of what else could be going on. Of course, we have our volcanic gas, we have our atmospheric escape, but we also have this crustal water reservoir that is forming all these water-bearing minerals, both in the Noachian and in the Hesperian. But once we get to the Amazonian period, we actually aren't seeing evidence that a lot of crustal hydration, as we call it, is happening in that period. So what we have to do is take into account also this crustal hydration phenomenon and the time evolution of these three periods. So this is what our model looks like compared to the two other models that we just went through. You'll see that we have another sink to this model, which is this crustal water reservoir that I just talked about a lot. And that's sort of the new thing to these models that hadn't been considered before. And then what you can't see in this schematic is that we also have this free period time step evolution, because these sources and sinks change over these three periods. And we actually have some observational constraints on that change. So now we're going to step through how each of these sinks and sources actually affect our D2H budget and ultimately our simulation results. We'll start by thinking about how this hydrated mineral formation should affect our hydrogen isotopes. So I have written out here how you actually model isotopic fractionations through a very like this approach called Rayleigh distillation, which is the general way that you model isotopic reservoirs. And so you see that the isotopic composition of your reservoir is going to, of course, be dependent on your fractionation factor. And so one easy thing to think is that the change in your isotopic fractionation is going to be directly related to your fractionation factor. That is true, but it's also going to be affected by your residual fraction of the exchangeable water reservoir. This really means how much water are you removing out of the system. And that's where the formation of hydrated minerals is really going to affect your model, because the crustal hydration, well, most of these chemical reactions don't actually have a huge fractionation. They have some fractionation associated with them. They do remove a huge amount of water from the exchangeable water reservoir. And so you're diminishing the exchangeable water reservoir, and you need now much less fractionation, much less distillation to actually increase your D2H. And so that's how it's going to affect results. Now, for the actual model, we use these sort of back on the envelope calculations by integrating all of these different data sets that I walked through before to get these ranges of the crustal water reservoirs for the Noachian and Hesperian. So let's take a look at the parameters in this model. We're going to start out by varying our crustal water reservoir size, or our crustal hydration flux. We also have some parameters pertaining to volcanic degassing, atmospheric escape that I'll talk about a bit later. And then our time evolution, what are the dates for each of these three periods? And then our initial conditions. Our initial reservoir size is the free parameter that we're trying to model. And then the initial D2H composition is based off of our D2H measurements in our meteorites and same samples. So now we're going to look at one of the results, which is the DWH of the exchangeable water reservoir through geological time. I want you to first look at the difference between the solid line and the dashed line. In this case, the solid line represents if you have the maximum amount of Noachian crustal water, and the dashed line is the minimum amount in this case. And you'll see that, as we expected from the previous slide, if you have more Noachian crustal hydration, that's going to cause more of an upturn in D2H during the Noachian. Now, there's also a trade-off between the dark green lines and the light green lines, and that's the trade-off between having maximum amount and minimum amount of Hesperian crustal hydration. So the Hesperian crustal hydration is going to put some limits on how much crustal hydration you can have in the Noachian and vice versa. So there's a trade-off there as well that's also going to be controlling the D2H evolution. So let's take a look at the effects of volcanic degassing. We have actually measured the sort of igneous D2H composition in a lot of meteorites. Generally, they're very low. So the expectation is that mixing with volcanic gas will decrease the D2H of the exchangeable water reservoir. Because if you have a lot of gas that has a very low D2H, mixing with this high D2H atmosphere, of course, the total D2H of the atmosphere is going to decrease. The way that we constrain volcanic degassing is based on thermochemical models that we modified from previous studies, specifically these Grotteol studies. And these volcanic degassing curves have been compared with the evolution in volcanic provinces that are observed through orbital imagery. And you'll see that there is quite a large range of what is possible. There's a lot of different parameters that these models are dependent on, but the two most important ones is first the control of this curve shape. So you'll see there's some changes in curve shape, and that's related to what we call global melts or mantle plume scenarios, which is basically represents the assumed area of surface degassing. So either you can have degassing of sort of the global surface, or you can have degassing in concentrated plume channels. The other parameter is what's controlling the absolute amount of outgas water, and that's actually proportional to the assumed initial mantle water content. So how much water you have in the mantle at the beginning of these simulations. We have kind of measured this in meteorites to be about 100 to 1000 ppm of water. So we vary this through this possible range, and that's what gives rise to these different in-member scenarios of volcanic degassing that we use in the model. So let's range these different volcanic models. The F mantle here represents this initial mantle water content, and the R mantle represents the D2H composition of this gas that we have measured approximately through meteorite measurements. So these are the results that you get. Four different colors are related to the four different colored models from before. The takeaway from this plot is that in some of these low outgassing scenarios, the D2H is increasing through geological time. But in some of the higher outgassing scenarios, you can actually have a decrease in D2H. And so this trade-off between how much water you have at the time of the Hesperian and how much water is outgassing at that time is really going to affect your D2H evolution from that period of time. And it's a really important control on the expected D2H evolution of the Martian atmosphere. The line styles here are reflecting the D2H composition of the gas. And so you'll see that, of course, if the gas has a bit different composition, that is going to, in some scenarios, affect the results quite a lot as well. Okay, so let's take a look at the effects of atmospheric escape. This is the same phenomenon that we already talked about. So higher hydrogen escape flux is going to increase the D2H more because you're accumulating the deuterium and you're removing the lighter hydrogen. But the big question is, how high or how low was the hydrogen escape flux in the Noachian and the Hesperian? For today, or what we sort of assume to represent the Amazonian hydrogen escape flux, we've actually measured that. We've seen with our instruments how much hydrogen is being lost, but we can't do the same measurement for the Noachian and Hesperian. So in our study, we use this photochemical model that's called kinetics and comes out of the young group here at Caltech. And we model what different possible hydrogen escape fluxes would be in different atmospheric structures. So in this first panel, you see that if you have a higher surface pressure representing you have a thicker atmosphere, essentially, a thicker atmosphere is going to cause your hydrogen escape flux to decrease. So you would actually expect that the hydrogen escape flux in the past was a bit lower than today because the hydrogen has to move from more material. But in a different type of structure, if you have, for example, convection, so in this middle scenario, we are taking some water and then putting it into a higher altitude, which is what effectively convection would do, you're going to actually have higher hydrogen escape fluxes. And in this last scenario, there is a range of different geological processes, such as different chemical reactions of rocks, volcanic outgassing, even impacts can actually bring hydrogen into the system at the surface, and that's also going to increase your hydrogen escape flux. So depending on the different atmospheric structure at the time, there's actually a really large possible range of what your past hydrogen escape flux could be. So let's take a look at how this like large range of past escape fluxes is going to affect the model. In this case, you see if you have a higher Noachian escape flux, that's going to cause a higher increase in DOH. We already expected that. And the same thing for the Hesperian. Now what we're going to do, because we have such a large possible range, we're going to try to put some constraints on this by varying all of our parameters within these pretty large parameter ranges that are based on observational data. We are also going to use our simulation constraints. So we want to recreate the DOH composition of the atmosphere today, and we want to recreate the size of the exchangeable water reservoir today, which is based on these ice deposits. And so we're going to look at the combination of Hesperian escape fluxes and Noachian escape fluxes that can explain these simulation constraints. And this is the result that you get. So it's a pretty relatively large solution space. What is really interesting and one of the main takeaway points here is that there actually are combinations of past escape fluxes that are possible that explain all of our observations that are actually the same as today. So that's this part of the solution space. And this is the first time that a model can actually recreate this DOH evolution and this water history with atmospheric escape fluxes that are similar to what we observe today. But then there are other simulations. Let's say that the atmospheric structure was completely different in the past than today, in which case some very high Noachian and Hesperian escape flux is also possible. So this kind of gives rise to two end members of simulations, an end member where the atmospheric escape is very small and an end member where the atmospheric escape is very high. And so if you read the paper, many of our results are given in these ranges, and that's where these ranges come from. So let's look at the minimum escape end member. This is where the atmospheric escape is the same as today throughout the whole time. The integrated amount of escape is really small, and all the water loss, 99% of it, is lost to this crustal reservoir forming these water-bearing minerals. Now, in this other maximum escape end member of the simulations, there's more of a split. There is actually quite a lot of atmospheric escape, accounting for 70% of the water loss, but at least 30% of water is still lost to this crustal reservoir size. So this means that the crustal reservoir size can either be actually the predominant mechanism for water loss on Mars, or it's more of a split and the atmospheric escape and crustal water is equally important. Then the last thing we can do is we can take a look at the simulations of the exchangeable water reservoir size through geological time. So we want to know how much water was present in different periods of Martian history. So we'll start by looking at this Noachian period, which is the blue period here. And we can also compare it to what other studies have been able to model for the Noachian. You'll see that a lot of our simulations actually can simulate quite a bit more water in the Noachian Pass, a bit more compatible with this 100 to 1000 meter GL range. Our simulations ranges from this 100 to 1500 meter GL of water, depending on your parameter assumptions. Then we can move on to the Hesperian. So there is going to be quite a lot of decrease in the water during the Noachian, and so we'll have lower levels in the Hesperian, but a lot of our simulations actually show a lot of water in the Hesperian. There is a proposed Hesperian ocean coming out of this Carr and Head study, where they calculate that there was about 100 meter GL of water in the Hesperian in this proposed ocean. I want to point out that there isn't any assumption that there needs to be an ocean in our model. We're just saying that if you needed 100 meter GL of water, then a lot of our simulations would be compatible with that. But there also are some scenarios in a model where a more dry Hesperian is simulated as well. We know that there at least was some water in the Hesperian because it formed all these lake environments, but in that case, they would have been more local. But a lot of the simulations show a lot of water in the Hesperian. Then by the time we reach the Amazonian, we actually have pretty low and actually constant water levels. The reason for this is because we're assuming there's no crustal hydration in the Amazonian. We're assuming also that the volcanic degassing is really low. That's what these different observations and models are showing, because your mantle has cooled. And we don't see a lot of evidence for volcanic activity in the Amazonian. And also your hydrogen escape is going to be really low as well. So they're like basically countering each other, and water levels remain pretty low throughout the Amazonian. Okay, so let's go all the way back to planetary habitability and talk about why this is important for the perspective of continuous planetary habitability in particular. The thing to think about in terms of crustal hydration is that on Earth, we also have crustal hydration, like all of you have seen clays on rocks and that kind of thing, but we have volatile recycling. So we are recycling our crust through tectonics, and that gives rise to, for example, dehydration of our crust, which eventually induces volcanism, and then the volatiles are outgassed again. So we can think about tectonics as sort of like a volatile recycling mechanism that is always making sure that we have sustained volatiles and water in our hydrologic cycle. On Mars, we aren't really seeing evidence for this same recycling mechanism, because it is evident that a lot of these water-bearing minerals formed early on, very similar to on Earth, but then they just stayed there in the ancient crust. Not a lot happened to the ancient crust. And so you have to think about this crustal hydration phenomenon as an irreversible crustal sink on Mars, as opposed to volatile recycling. And so that is really a major control on the timeline of Mars losing its water, because we aren't sustaining water through this recycling mechanism. The timeline for continuous planetary habitability is quite different on Mars, and a lot of this water is lost before 3 billion years ago. So I have a small segment after this, but these are the take-home messages of this particular study. We showed that the drying of Mars was, at least in part, caused by sequestration of ocean-scale water volumes in the crust. And including this phenomenon of crustal hydration in models like these actually provides a solution for some of the previously interpreted discrepancies, which was, how can you have such a large heat-rate isotopic fractionation, such a low hydrogen escape rate, and have so much water based on geological data sets? So this is actually a way to show that these aren't actually discrepancies. This kind of makes sense if you take into account crustal hydration. This ultimately has a pretty big effect on the global continuous habitability on Mars, because we see most of this water is lost before 3 billion years ago. And this means that this irreversible crustal sink on Mars is very kind of a different control as compared to the climatic evolution on Earth, where we have the volatile recycling mechanism. So then the question is, what is next? So I wanted to talk a little bit about perseverance, because I actually started out my PhD doing a lot of the orbital characterization of this ancient crust. So looking at all these water-bearing minerals from orbit within the mission site of the Perseverance rover. So let's take a little bit of a look at what Perseverance is going to do and how that can actually help our model and help test some of the simulations in our model. So Perseverance landed right here in the middle of what has been interpreted to be a Hesperian lake system, and it's going to drive someone like this up the delta, and then it's going to enter what we call the extended mission area, which is this really ancient crustal system. And so in the primary mission and within this lake system, it's going to try to understand if this lacustrine system was habitable and what kinds of climates dominated this lake activity and gave rise to also a lot of hydrated mineral formation in this lake system. Once we reach the extended mission, this is where we're going to actually for the first time with a rover study the really ancient crust on Mars. So here is a compilation stratigraphy of a lot of studies, including one that I had for this Noachian basement group, and a lot of studies by my advisor Bethany Elman and her advisor Jack Mustard. And you can see that this bottom part of the stratigraphy is actually what we will explore in the extended mission. And this encompasses a time period that is from 3 to 8 to 4 billion years old. Possibly even older materials are in the stratigraphy as well. And what we'll be doing is studying both the igneous lithologies, but for this particular purpose, importantly also the minerals that formed in these aqueous environments, these water-bearing minerals like clays, carbonates that we have observed so many places and this model is built upon, but the processes for their formation aren't fully well understood yet. So that's what we're going to study within this stratigraphy. We're going to investigate if any of these environments were habitable and try to understand what the nature and change was in these aqueous processes that formed all these water-bearing minerals. Another really important aspect is that we are actually going to return samples. For this particular sort of topic, these samples can be measured for isotopic, hydrogen isotopic signatures that go directly into helping constrain our models better. And we can also better constrain the water contents of this ancient Noachian crust, for example, through these return samples. So to put this into perspective, if we look at this result figure that I showed earlier on, you can see that we had a lot of possible scenarios for D2H simulations depending on assumptions for different volcanic models. That was what gave rise to, for example, continuous increase in D2H or this decrease in D2H. What you'll notice here is that these gray boxes actually represent the data that we have available. And so there's a huge interval in which additional data points would be super helpful for refuting some of these simulations or accepting some of the other ones. So that can really help us constrain which simulations are reasonable and which aren't. And then last, as we try to constrain the exact nature of these processes that led to water-bearing mineral formation, we can start having much more mechanistic models that take into account the exact process that is forming the crustal hydration. Remember, this model I'm presenting is mostly just based on the observational ranges of how much water we actually see and don't necessarily take into account the complex geological processes that are behind and driving all this water into the crust. And that's also going to help us understand a lot better what the rate was and modeling the rate of this crustal hydration process over time for some more detailed models. So in summary, you know, our free summary points for the particular study I presented on, and then a summary of what Perseverance can do to help further constrain the study. It will compare aqueous environments from these two key time periods, the Noachian and Hesperian, and it's going to, for the first time, actually constrain these aqueous processes in the early Noachian, which is this 4 billion years ago, where a lot of these water-bearing minerals are observed. And then it's actually also going to be able to sample materials that can be measured for water contents and hydrogen isotopic compositions. And that will actually really help further test our scenarios and hopefully shrink our solution space a bit. And that is all I have today to talk about. And I'll be very happy to take any questions.
Thank you so much, Ava. It's a little hard sometimes to express applause, the usual applause or crowd appreciation over these virtual formats, but that was an excellent talk. Thank you very much. If there are any questions for Ava, please type them in the chat and I can read them off to her. Otherwise, if you would like to ask your question directly, then please note that in the chat and I'll ask you to unmute and so you can ask them. And just to start things off a little bit, Ava, I know that you weren't necessarily dealing with the more mechanistic process of exactly how this water became hydrated. Do you have any possible ideas of how that could be, not necessarily detailed, but what processes do you think might be involved with that?
Sure. Yeah. There's a lot of, sometimes I sort of call them different camps of favorite processes. I think a lot of the time geological systems turn out to not be the same on a whole global scale. So, a lot of suggestions for this kind of hydration is formed in, for example, sedimentary systems. Another camp is chemical weathering. So it's more of like an infiltration of water, maybe even as groundwater systems in the subsurface that can, cause water to interact with the rock. There's also more like impact-driven infiltration. So you actually need the formation of impact craters to drive a lot of this infiltration and that kind of thing. We have sort of a lot of evidence that sedimentary processes was at least a big part of it on a local scale. And I guess I don't really see a reason why you can't have multiple of these environments in different settings that, in the end, they make water-bearing minerals, all of them, all together. Yeah. I guess one last one I should say is that, of course, the ocean hypothesis is another big one that sort of goes to sedimentary systems as well, not necessarily lakes, but ocean is a big way to form a lot of that as well. So, yeah. I really am excited about finally being able to see the early Noachian crust from the rover perspective, because it is very hard to make constraints about that kind of process from orbital imagery alone. And so I think that's going to really help us. Yeah.
Excellent. We have a question from, and I apologize ahead of time if I mispronounce your name, Maitrey Bose of ASU. So thanks for the talk. Can you talk about how deep would the water-bearing minerals in the crust be? If there is so much water sequestration, I imagine the crustal mineralogy would be starkly different on Mars compared to Earth.
Yeah, so I kind of, let me actually loop back to this, because I kind of had it early on in the presentation. And I know there's a lot of material, so it's kind of understandable that we got lost a little bit. Okay, yeah, so we actually have some observations on this. So if you remember, I was talking about how we have really deep parts of the crust excavated. We actually have down to 10 kilometers excavated. Unfortunately, we can't really see deeper than that, but in these cases where we have 5 to 10 kilometers of this ancient crust excavated, we actually see hydrated minerals all the way down. It's still sort of a open question, and there's a lot of sort of mission thinking, at least, that goes into thinking about how we can try to resolve this vertical structure a bit better. But observationally, we just see a lot of water-bearing minerals in the deep crust. And that's what's been driving a lot of these theories about how you need to have some subsurface infiltration process, some subsurface groundwater process to form these water-bearing minerals so deep in the crust. In terms of the mineralogy being different on Mars compared to Earth, it's actually pretty similar in terms of the mineral groups that you're expecting. So you're expecting clay, you're expecting a deeper depth where you have a higher pressure and temperature, some of the more metamorphic. examples of these hydrated minerals, so that's quartz, serpentine, that kind of thing. We observe that. The only thing is that the cations on Mars are typically iron magnesium, because, you know, basaltic crust and all that kind of thing. So you source the iron and magnesium much more, whereas on Earth, the counterpart is a lot more aluminum rich because we have a lot more aluminum. So some of the same mineral groups that we expect, but different cations sometimes.
Thank you. Yash Srivastana asks, please comment on the early loss of water during primordial times. Do we have any study related to that?
Oh, primordial times, yeah. So the primordial time of Mars is interesting, and a lot of stuff is happening at that time that aren't necessarily relevant to the time scale that we looked at in our paper, where we sort of, you know, we started our model at 4 billion years ago, so that looking at the more geological processes as opposed to the primordial processes. But that said, there are a lot of other studies, so like not ours, but a lot of other studies do focus on the primordial times. The major difference here is that you have actually a lot of sort of quote unquote exotic processes affecting your water at the time. So you can both have this proposed magma oceans where you're like have degassing of like a steam atmosphere. The idea is that you also have hydrodynamic escape at that time. So you're actually escaping through a, quite a different process than you are in the subsequent non-primordial period. And so, yeah, there's a lot of studies based on that, both in like the hydrodynamic groups, a lot of studies by Bruce Tarkowski and that kind of person. And then a lot of studies from the magmatic modeling side of things as well. Oh yeah, magnetic field is another good one. So there's also a lot of studies from the magnetic field, because of course, if you have a magnetic field, that's also going to affect how your atmospheric loss processes are and that kind of thing.
Excellent, thank you. So yeah, you addressed Sarah Port's question there. Do you have any other questions from the chat, or if anybody wants to unmute and ask a question directly, please let me know. Ah, here's one from Arthur Perry. Post-Perseverance, will we have sufficient data to build an experimental water extraction device for a later mission?
Oh yeah, I get this question a lot because it's very, you know, it's very, everyone's excited about extracting water in Mars. You know, I sometimes feel like this is a more of an engineering question. And I try to think about it from sort of like a theoretical standpoint. And from a theoretical standpoint, you can extract water from these rocks. So we do that in the lab by heating the rocks and then you release the gas. And then you, you know, you could just freeze that gas and you would have water. The one point though is that you have to have any appreciable amount of water, you need to heat so much rock that engineering wise, then it might be sort of difficult to heat, you know, a ton of rock to create a little bit of water, if you know what I mean. But you know, we have a lot of water in the rocks also on Earth, similar to Mars. So it's not definitely not the easiest way. Theoretically, you can extract that water if you really wanted to, but it's going to be very small amounts of water.
Excellent. Do you have any more questions for Ava? If not, well, thank you very much. Please show your appreciation in the chat if you wish. That would be very, it was a great talk, Ava. I really appreciate you coming here.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me and for inviting me.
This seminar will be available via the LPI seminars website. It's been recorded, so really, if you'd like to go back and see anything again, that will be available at a later date. Our seminar next week will be Dr. Elizabeth Frank, and that'll be at the same time, 3 o'clock on Thursday. So please come back for that. Thank you again, Ava. Really appreciate you being here.